We like to provide these little conundrums for you to think about. And we're going to provide a big conundrum for you. At this stage, we're going to introduce the economics of enough, how to run an economy as if the future matters. So we move from semi-insoluble problems at the individual level to totally insoluble problems at the international and national levels. But I think we have the top speaker in the world right now with us to address this, and that is Diane Coyle. And Diane hails from the United Kingdom. As you can see, I'm extrapolating through further levels of generalization and distance from the United States to try to help us all get a better perspective on who we are, where we're headed, what we're going to do with the challenges that we face. And by bringing in people from other disciplines such as economics and from other parts of the world who've struggled with some of the same problems we have, I'm hoping that it's going to challenge our thinking as we often do think, even though we're a big nation, very parochially about how to solve our problems. Europe and the United Kingdom have been facing the same kinds of general economic problems we have here in the United States for a long time, and particularly the acute ones more recently. So Diane has a stellar academic credentials as well, PhD from Harvard in economics. She's grounded in the nuts and bolts, having been an economist at the UK Treasury, European editor of Investors Chronicle, economics editor of The Independent. In addition, she's the founding director of Enlightenment Economics, a consultancy that specialized in global and technological issues. I like that, Enlightenment Economics. It reminds us that the Enlightenment did happen. There is hope. We need to create a new Enlightenment in this country and in this world. And Diane is on the track in terms of trying to convince us some ways we might approach that. I first learned of her work reading a review of her book in the New York Times. That book was entitled The Economics of Enough, How to Run the Economy as If the Future Matters. We had recently had James Galbraith as the keynote speaker to this conference when I read Diane's book review. And it occurred to me that that's what James Galbraith was trying to tell us. Stop trying to measure ourselves exclusively by the gross national product as the sum total of who we are as a people. Diane Coyle is the next stage in our education as we move away from thinking about the GNP as the sum total of who we are as a nation and begin to think of other metrics like families and developmental disabilities. What are the other metrics we should measure about our society other than our gross national product to tell us when we're on track? Ladies and gentlemen, Diane Coyle.
Well, thank you for that introduction, and good morning, everybody. It's a real pleasure and privilege to have this opportunity to talk to you. As you heard, I'm an economist. We've already heard a lot this morning about some of the economic and other challenges that you are facing here. And I'm going to talk about actually a wider set of challenges that are faced not just by the United States, but by other countries as well. They're common to at least all of the developed world and maybe some of the developing countries as well. But I'm not going to plunge straight into equations and charts, which isn't what economists normally do. I want to start with a story. And this story starts in 2007. In the fall, I got a phone call from my sister, who only really likes to talk to me when things are going very badly wrong. She doesn't speak very much on the telephone. And so I knew something serious was going on. And she had recently retired and put all her pension savings in a building society called Northern Rock. They're a little bit like savings and loan institutions. And she had seen on the news photographs of people in line outside the local branch of Northern Rock because the bank was insolvent and there was a run on the bank. Hadn't happened since the 19th century in the UK. You can tell this is England, by the way, because although these people are desperately worried about their life savings, they formed an orderly queue outside the bank. But you can tell that they're really worried because it's not quite a straight line. Now, of course, the financial crisis spread. That was just an early indicator of the scale of the problems in the financial system. And a year later, we got the collapse of Lehman Brothers, and the freezing up of the interbank markets and the big bailouts of banks across the developed world. And right after Lehman Brothers collapsed, and I heard that on the news, I read the Financial Times every day, and I saw a chart that shows the rate at which banks lend each other money overnight. What do they charge in interest? Called the interbank offer rate. And it had gone off the chart, literally. It had become so high. And I said, if they don't trust each other with their money, I don't trust them with my money either. And so for the next week, I went to the cash machine and I took out as much as it would give me and hid away the cash, because if that system froze up, how was I going to buy food for my family? And I have a lot of books at home, so I put all the money in different books, which is fantastic, because I pull a book off the shelf at the moment and every so often £50 falls out of it. So that really paid off. We're still mid-crisis, of course. The European banks are in big trouble again because they lent money to the Greek government, which is insolvent, so the banks may be insolvent. This matters to America, too, because although the US banks were not stupid enough to lend to the Greek government, knowing that it couldn't be repaid, they were stupid enough to lend money to Deutsche Bank and Societe Generale. So again, the financial system is starting to seize up. Why am I talking to you about the financial system? Well, for two reasons. One is that the behavior of the banks is symbolic of the way the economy has come to be run, not in the public interest, but for the interest of certain groups, and banks are definitely one of those, but also because of the impact on government finances. So we've heard a lot about that already. I've just got one chart to show you. This is the US federal government deficit. And that's a lot of red ink up there. Actually, it's worse in some European countries than even in the United States. So the chart shows the percentage of GDP accounted for by the imbalance between expenditure and savings at the federal level. And there was one brief moment in the post-war era since 1950 when there was a surplus. And with hindsight, we can look back and call that the Clinton budget surplus. It's the only time it's happened. There was a dividend from ending the Cold War and an economic boom to thank for that. But overall, the trend has been pretty serious. It's been adverse, and it is very, very much worse recently. So this is the biggest peacetime deficit that there has been as a share of GDP. Now, the last years on this chart are actually forecasts. We're just about at that bottom point at the moment, and the official forecast is that it will start to get a little bit better, although still a pretty serious figure. Now, you might think I'm a little skeptical, but I don't believe those forecasts. This is a cartoon that shows the innate human tendency to predict that good times are just around the corner. Now, one reason I don't believe it is I don't want to comment on US politics because I'm a foreigner, but I will say there isn't obviously any scope for non-partisan agreement about how to get expenditures and revenues in line with each other. The US has been downgraded by some credit rating agencies. And actually, the situation is even worse than is commonly acknowledged. And Nancy touched on this in her talk. Because the official budget headlines don't take account of all the extra spending that's going to be mandated if nothing changes in the system, and if nothing changes in the demographic trends, in how the average age of the population, in how long people live after retirement, in their likely needs for healthcare and other care when they're older. If you take account of all of those things, and of course you have to make a lot of assumptions about it, and that's the excuse that politicians normally give for not using these kind of generational accounts. If you take account of all those, you get a really serious outlook indeed, and much worse than even the press comment acknowledges. And so I don't want to dwell on this because Nancy talked about it, but again, to show you one chart about what difference it makes. This is a chart taken from a recent International Monetary Fund publication for the United States, and it's what the deficit looks like, the federal deficit looks like when you include promises that are made but not actually budgeted yet. This is the demographic, the impact of the demographic change and structural change. And you can see the effect of compound arithmetic, it goes up very quickly. Now, unsustainable things don't get sustained, and they can change in lots of ways. So one way things could improve would be for the economy to start growing much faster than it has been. We could have another productivity miracle, as we had in the late 1990s. again, one might, I think it's a little bit optimistic to rely on that. Of course, we could get political agreement to change the tax base, increase taxes, a consensus about how to trim expenditure, and that would make these figures look better as well. But there's likely to have to be some change in the kind of structures that we have grown familiar with, the structures of healthcare, the structures of caregiving, the structures of pensions as well, because that's another part of this demographic burden. But this is actually quite a big change in our societies, and particularly I think in the United States, where the idea that there's improvement, there's continuous improvement in living standards from one generation to the next, is part of the fabric of the culture and the fabric of all political debate. And actually, we have years of austerity ahead of us in all the Western societies. Years of budget austerity that call into question the framework we've had for thinking about how do we do welfare, how do we support older people, how do we make sure that, that care is given. So the financial crisis has been very much front of mind, and it was what triggered me to write the book in the first place, that awful moment of realization that I might not be able to get cash out of the machine next week. But it's only one of three areas, I would say, where there has been a crisis of stewardship in the economy. One of the others is environmental, which is a huge debate. I'm not going to talk about it very much today. I'm not going to go into climate change, what are average temperatures, what's the role of human activity in raising temperatures. But just to flag up that there is a wider issue about whether in using natural resources we have even thought about how much we leave for future generations and what the impact will be on their quality of life. And I would argue that we haven't thought about it. We're only just starting to think through what is the impact of our energy use, but also what is the impact of all human economic activity. It's just not the way we've framed thinking about it. A third crisis is about the fabric of society. This is a picture of Camden, New Jersey, which I found on the internet. But it could be many places. It could be many places in the Rust Belt. It could be many parts of northern France or the north of the United Kingdom. Although actually, I would say to you, as a European speaking to a mainly American audience, there are parts of the United States, of US cities, that absolutely shock any visitors from Europe when they do see them. But this is a common problem, deindustrialization, the loss of well-paid jobs for people who don't have high academic qualifications, the extent of poverty in all of our societies, the proportion of households where nobody has a job and they don't have the capabilities to get into work. And this offends a kind of fairness instinct. And I think there's a lot of evidence now from cognitive science and psychology that actually people do have a very deep-seated instinct about what's fair and what's not fair. And exactly what that is varies from country to country and over time. But the instinct that there are things that are not fair is a very strong one. And the extent of poverty, I think, has come to offend that instinct for fairness. But also, because, not just because it's affecting the very poorest in our societies now, but because it's affecting great swathes of the middle of society as well. The opportunity for middle classes to get on, for their children to be better off than they were themselves. What are their job prospects? What are their educational chances? And this is not just about what taxes will they have to pay and what level of public services. It is about opportunities and whether we have a society that means that over time, the next generations have as good a chance as we had at making a good life for themselves. I think this explains, actually, both the Tea Party and the Occupy Wall Street movement. That anger about prospects is driving people to get out on the streets and protest now. It's certainly what's driving the riots in countries like Greece and Spain, because it's the great mass of people in the middle who are angry. It's not the very poor. The very poor just don't have the energy, actually, to get out and demonstrate. And this crisis in society is much worse for the very poorest, who don't have any opportunities at all, but it's very widespread. And it manifests itself in particular in inequality statistics, where this is one area where the United States actually leads the world still, in having the most unequal distribution of incomes in the developed world. But again, it's not the only country. This is a common phenomenon of much greater inequality in the recent past than in the 1950s and 60s and 70s. So this chart shows the proportion of incomes going to the top 1% of earners in the United States. So actually, it understates disparity because it excludes wealth. And you can see that the level of inequality in incomes is back to what it was in the Gilded Age of the 1920s. Does that matter? Well, there's no very conclusive economic evidence on whether having an unequal society is good or bad for economic growth, and you can argue it both ways. But I think there is evidence that having this kind of inequality does not actually increase the growth rate. And it's at an extreme position where it's become quite harmful for society and that sense of cohesion, actually for the civility of everyday life. And that matters as much as exactly what is the rate of GDP growth. It matters because trust is very important in modern economies. Now, actually, trust underpins every economy anyway, because if we didn't trust each other in transactions, every exchange would be like handing over the money for a ransom demand. You know, you'd hand over the money and you'd want to get the victim back at the same time. And transactions are not like that. We trust somebody that if we send off a check in the mail, we'll get the goods that we ordered. We trust people. We trust the banking system, foolish as that might seem sometimes. So trust is fundamental to any economy anyway. But it's become more important over time because of the way the economy itself is changing. When you have an economy that's mainly doing manufacturing jobs and people work on assembly lines, it's pretty easy to tell how hard they're working and whether their work's any good, because the goods roll off the end of the line and you can tell whether they work or not, and you can observe how many rivets somebody hits, or whatever you do to a rivet, each day. So that's easy to monitor. But we don't have that kind of economy anymore. It's, I think, about 14% of GDP in the US in manufacturing now. We have a service economy and a very technologically advanced one. So whether you've got somebody who is a care assistant or writing advanced software programs, you just can't tell how well they're doing their job. It's really hard to monitor. And you can't take advantage of the kind of advances in information technology that we've seen if you don't trust people to work with the information it gives them. So in the old corporations, there was a hierarchy that information flowed up and down, and people did what they were told when they were down the hierarchy. If you want to take advantage of the internet and computer system that puts information at everybody's fingertips, then you've got to trust them to use that information. So in a service-based economy, and one that has a lot of high-tech industries, trust has become more important than ever. And that trust, I think, is crumbling because of the kind of inequality and social problems and the loss of hope in the middle classes that we have seen. So this inequality is a really serious economic problem as well as a social problem. You just don't have a thriving, high-tech, service-based economy if people are losing trust in each other. These technological changes are massive, actually. Information and communication technologies are what economists call a general-purpose technology, which is that they can be used in everything and they affect everything in the economy. And we don't think about them very clearly. There's a term, presbyopia, which means basically middle-aged eyesight. You are both short-sighted and long-sighted at the same time. And I certainly got that problem myself. And it's a bit like that thinking about technology. People overhype massively the effects of technology short-term. So we had the dot-com boom and the bubble in the share price index, and everybody thought that things were going to be transformed overnight and it would all be marvelous, and that was hype. But the longer-term effects of the technologies are massively underestimated. And so when people looked at the railways in Victorian times, and there was a share price bubble about those as well, and that burst, and people got very unexcited. But actually, having railways created urbanization because you could take food in from outlying rural areas into the cities. And without urbanization, we just wouldn't have the kind of economy that we developed in the 20th century. So the long-term effects of technical change of these general-purpose technologies, like steam or electricity, or the information and communication technologies, are very large indeed, and very difficult to predict over long horizons. But the adjustments that we're all making are enormous, actually, when you think about the delayering of corporations, the outsourcing, the growth of network corporations, the spread of production chains across all the globe so that anything you buy is made in 26 different countries and not just one. The corporate reorganizations, the different skills that people need, the way that whole industries have been torpedoed by the technologies, whether it's music or movies or publishing. And that's just all the obvious stuff. There's actually a kind of change in the economy that is subtler and, I think, harder and more important long term. And this is going to seem like going off on a tangent, but I want you to think about a symphony orchestra. This is a picture from the BBC Proms. This is the Royal Albert Hall. And all these 5,000 people are listening to a symphony. Symphony orchestras are limited in how much they can increase their productivity over time. They can play more concerts in a year. They could do one every night instead of every other night and take advantage of trains and planes to get to different places. If they record their concerts, they can hope to sell a few more recordings. But there's a limit to how much productivity you can get out of a symphony orchestra, because what they can't do is play the symphony with six violins and play it twice as fast as it's meant to be played. You know, there's a real limit on those productivity gains. And at the same time, people who play in orchestras want to live, and they want to have living standards that aren't too remote from the rest of the society in which they live. So performers are probably paid a bit less on average than the average salary for the economy as a whole, paid a lot less than lawyers and bankers, but they won't get too out of line. They need to be paid a decent living. What that says is that the share of the national income pie that goes on paying for orchestras is actually going to go up over time, because their productivity doesn't, that stays more or less flat, but their incomes are going to have to go up. The tickets sold have to cover the performers' salaries. Now, that might seem like a small problem. You know, it's a very small part of the economy, even though the arts are growing and they're important economically. But this is a bit of a dramatic hyperbole with the picture. There are lots of parts of the economy that actually turn out to be quite a lot like the performing arts, where the scope for productivity changes is not net zero, but it's quite limited. But you're going to want to carry on paying people a decent living. And there are all kinds of services that are like that, including caring for the elderly, caring for people with disabilities, teaching, childcare, nursing. You know, if you think about a nurse, for example, becoming more productive, you wouldn't say she was more productive if she could fit twice as many patients in a day. In fact, the reverse might be true. You might actually want to see nurses get less productive over time and spend more time, ideally, with each patient. But this is a huge issue. We've got these economies that are two-thirds services, at least, and a lot of them are affected by these economics of limited productivity gains. Now, in a lot of them, technology can do something. You can have online teaching, so access to one teacher by very many students. In the areas that you're interested in, technologies can do something to improve productivity, but there's a limit to it, because at the essence of the service is the contact between one person and another. That's what services are all about. And we are going to have to figure out, as societies, ways to transfer money from the productive part, GDP from the productive parts of the economy, where you do get lots of productivity gains, to the unproductive parts, which is actually the majority of the economy now. I mean, to caricature it, how do we get the money from the bankers to the caregivers is the problem. And this is complicated, too, by the fact that quite a lot of the services that we're talking about are provided by governments. So if we're spending more money on them over time, that's saying that more money is going through government budgets over time. And this is a bigger problem in Europe, where a very much higher proportion of care, healthcare, and education and so on go through the government, but it's also a problem here in the United States. And this is at the heart of civility, isn't it? Because what is the point of being a rich enough country to afford all the plasma TV screens you want, but not rich enough to listen to performances or to give care to people who are vulnerable and need it? So I've been talking about stewardship in the economy of enough, and it's clear that we want a lot of growth. You know, if we can get it, we want the economy to get going again and GDP to grow. But we have to think also about our legacy and what we're leaving for future generations. and I don't think we've been doing a very good job. The investment record in the United States and the United Kingdom and other European countries is pretty poor. And here again, in a dramatic hyperbole, is something that speaks about the state of the infrastructure in many countries. This is Interstate 35, the bridge that collapsed in Minneapolis a few years ago. But quite a lot of the infrastructure in economies that did a lot of their growing in the early 20th century is crumbling and needs replacing, and that replacement investment hasn't occurred. And the costs of this are very high. But there's an even bigger investment. Well, we have a backlog as well. This is my son when he was five, on his first day at our local primary school. He's, as you can see, not very happy about going. 10 years later, he's still not very happy about going to school at our local high school every day. We live in a very nice suburb of London. It's a school that's middling. You know, it has the characteristics of many urban public schools. There are a lot of people who have cognitive disabilities, physical disabilities, difficult family backgrounds. They come from many parts of the world. In the school, there are 20-odd different languages spoken, so there's assistance needed for that kind of teaching as well. In fact, in my son's very nice high school in a very nice suburb of London, 25% of the children have special educational needs. We've created somehow societies where we can and recognize the need to support people who have different kinds of needs. And also, I think we have, through social change, created a lot of families who need a lot of support. And the definition in the UK would include families where the social services are involved because of a violent family background or other sorts of problems. This is a very wide spectrum. But the point is that the needs are high in a nice place. And there are schools in London and in other cities, in the United Kingdom and in other cities in every developed country where the needs are absolutely enormous. And in your country, mine, the education record is poor. In the international league tables, we're slipping down. We're not doing very well on the cognitive abilities that education has come to focus on. And we're not doing very well in the kind of support that's needed. So the investment cost in this human capital is, I would say, as large as the investment needed in the physical capital and physical infrastructure. So governments need to invest, people need to invest. There's a backlog, there's a very high need, and we've got this terrible situation financially at the moment with the state of the economy. How do you get people to invest for the future? Well, you do need the money, but I think more important, you need the sense that there's going to be a return for the money and that the future is something worth investing in. And that's a sense that I think we have lost. And I often think about the Victorians. This is the town hall in the city where I grew up, Manchester, in the north of England. And it is an absolutely enormous, magnificent Gothic edifice. This is only a small part of the building, just to give you an impression of the scale. But also the confidence that people had to build that kind of thing. And it was built by civic collection, businessmen in Manchester. It wasn't a government building, although it is a civic building now. They had enough confidence in their future to invest in Manchester Town Hall, in masses of similar buildings across the country. They invested in the railways and the canals. They invested in schools and libraries. There was massive philanthropy. They shaped the country that we still live in. It's very importantly shaped by that massive investment of the late Victorian era. But this was a time of enormous, enormous social change and economic and technological change. The kind of technological changes that they lived through put ours in the shade, and people were scared. Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein because she was so scared about the implications of electricity. There was social upheaval. Charles Dickens wrote all his novels about the poverty and social dislocation of his time. And yet, at the same time as these tremendous fears and this tremendous upheaval, the tectonic shifts that Nancy mentioned, they had enough confidence in the future to make this kind of investment. And I've been asking myself, how do we regain that commitment to the future so that despite the mess in the economy, despite the tight budgets, we think it's worth investing in that profoundly important way. So, I mean, maybe you've been a bit, made a bit gloomy by the presentation so far this morning, but I want to wind up by talking about some ways that change can come about. And the first one, because I'm an economist and I like tables of statistics, is actually about measurement. We've focused entirely on measuring GDP. And I think GDP is really important. We need the economy to grow. We need it to grow faster. But GDP isn't by itself enough. It's a measure of income year to year. It's a flow. If you don't also measure assets, you're getting a very distorted picture of whether or not you're eating the future to pay for what you're consuming in the present. And it's also not the only thing that people care about. And in Australia, there has been a really interesting initiative over the last few years called Measuring Australia's Progress, where they decided they needed a dashboard of indicators about how the economy and society were doing. It would include GDP, very importantly, but it would have other things too. And they asked people what they thought was important. So the things they measure are based on a very large and annual public consultation by the Australian Statistical Authorities. And I think what people chose is really important and interesting. It comes under three headings, basically. One is about the kind of society they have. What capabilities do individuals have? Are they healthy? What's their education level? Do they have time for a rich leisure life with access to cultural performances and what have you? And also living together. What's the cohesion of the community like? What's the quality of the democracy? Is it easy to get from place to place? Do the transport links work well? So that's one set of headings. Then there's the economy, GDP, but also what's the wealth of the economy? What assets does it have? Productivity, how open to competition? And in each of these domains, there's a set of headline indicators and then a set of detailed indicators, and the authorities report on progress on these each year in an annual publication. Other countries are starting to do this. There has been recently a real surge of interest in going beyond GDP and measuring other things too. And so here in the US, these statisticians are starting to collect a range of indicators too. I don't think they're doing it in consultation. I think they're just drawing up that list themselves. But of course, there's a question about how do you use the measures to drive the political debate too. And just to emphasize, I wouldn't expect you to read this at a distance, but this is how to measure the wealth of the society as well as the income of the society from year to year. And economists divide capital into four different headings. And these are the ones that are being included in these new sets of measures. There's natural capital. What's the resource base of the country? How quickly is it being used up? The human capital, how educated are people? What are their grades, but also what are their non-academic skills and capabilities as well. Physical and financial capital, that's pretty obvious. What's the sum of money that people have in their savings accounts, but also are the bridges about to fall down? And then social capital, which is a kind of fuzzy but important concept about how well do societies cope together when things go wrong, essentially. So if I have a problem, I need somebody to help me. If I need to know something, it's probably not in my head. Most knowledge is outside myself and not inside myself. How well do societies help each other? So measurement is really important. Institutions are important too, though. This is a soup kitchen in a Baptist church in South Carolina. There are too many scenes like this these days. This is from a recent news report. But I just want to say, really, don't get obsessed with should the government do something or should it be left to the market. That's a false dichotomy in thinking about the economy, because the economy has all kinds of institutions, and actually it includes faith institutions. They're not just about the faith, they are economic and social institutions as well, and they are part of social capital. But there are all kinds of other institutions as well. There are companies, which are neither state nor market, but important economic entities themselves. There are unions, there are babysitting circles. There's a rich array of institutions in every economy. And institutions are important because they're the way that information is transmitted from one generation to the next. When I die, my knowledge dies with me, but if I've contributed to building an institution, some of the beliefs and values and knowledge will be transmitted on a longer time horizon. But above all, the important thing, I think, is about values. And this is something that economists are not typically comfortable talking about. For many years now, economics has been about is and not ought. And when I say this to audiences of economists, I get a sort of little nervous shuffling at this stage. It's not conventional territory for economics. But actually, it takes Adam Smith back to his origins. His first book was called A Theory of Moral Sentiments, and he meant that to be read alongside The Wealth of Nations, because the two go hand in hand. You don't have a healthy economy if you don't have a values-based society as well. And all of Western thought from the ancient Greeks onward have insisted that a successful economy rests on a strong sense of mutual responsibility. And for Aristotle, who is this guy, apparently, the allocation of scarce resources amongst people was a moral issue as well as an economic and market issue. So the economy is not an abstraction. It's about how people lead their lives. And for too long, we've separated the economic domain, and we see the results in the financial crisis and in the budget cuts that are happening now, about cutting thinking about the economy off from thinking about these moral issues as well. So I think the most important issue we face actually is how to bring thinking about the economy and thinking about values back together again after a 200-year separation. So I'm going to end with a plug for my book, which you can buy at all good booksellers, and how to contact me, because I'd really love to hear from you. And I think we have a little time for comments and questions now. Thank you.
I want to bring this home to you all in the sense that we've now had a view from across the pond, but it's a view that I think was characterized by considerable insight. We have very few development economists in the disability field. And Diane, I believe, could be characterized as a development economist. But we do have one, and his name is Bob Metz. And his PhD in development economics from the University of California at Berkeley. He's done extensive consultation with the World Bank. He's been a friend and colleague for 20 years. We use him to read and help us edit the state of the states in developmental disabilities to keep us honest. And so I decided this year to bring Bob out to the conference and give him an opportunity to speak, and can find no better opportunity to introduce him to you than to ask him, from an American perspective as a developmental economist, to respond to Dr. Metz, to Dr. Coyle. And here we have Bob Metz.
Wow, I appreciate the bravery of David for scheduling two economists in a row. And I think he really lucked out with Diane, because I think that was just really a very thought-provoking discussion, and it really related closely to what we're doing. Bravo. I think we can all agree with you, Diane, that that global economics sustainability is going to require a lot. It's going to require more efficient use of our resources. It's going to require a rethinking of many things, which will in turn require overcoming the rather daunting challenges that you've identified in your presentation and in your book. In your presentation, and even more so in your book, you demonstrate an amazing, I put remarkable in my notes, and I'm going to amazing. You demonstrate an amazing mastery of the big picture. You don't quite get it in a shortened presentation, but Diane covers everything, and virtually every economic school of thought in her discussion of each one of these issues. And she covers it from every point of view, from Adam Smith to Thorsten Veblen, to Amartya Sen, to even the Beatles are included in it. Bravo again. Now, I must applaud you for cogently debunking the traditional notion that wealth simply equals more stuff. And for adding your, again, incisive and incredibly well-informed voice to the push toward a more people-based conceptualization of wealth and of social welfare that takes into account future generations, which I agree, we policymakers and scholars in the field of economics just aren't doing. I like the approach to social welfare that you've settled upon, and I'm glad you used it in your presentation, because I picked it up in your book, the so-called dashboard approach. I like the name. And I like what it is. It basically has GDP in there as being important, but it's augmented by that large list of other indicators that broaden the idea of social well-being. As a 60s Berkeley guy, my rather psychedelic approach, my model of this is a giant structure sort of floating in space that resembles one of those molecular models that we got in college. You know, the ones with the little round balls connected by all the rods, big complex structure. I see that as social welfare, with each of the little shimmering balls, and again, it's multicolored, that's the Berkeley 60s part, and the balls are shimmering, of course, but each one of those, it represents one of the elements of social welfare, and they operate within a fascinating network of interconnectivities that are represented by the rods that connect them. Now, assuming, as my job here is to relate all this back to disability, assuming that it is good, making what economists call the normative assumption, that it's good to increase the health and the social and economic well-being of people with disabilities, the question becomes, how do I approach this mission conceptually? And the obvious two-stage answer to me is to first engage in research to determine what is in our best interest, our being people with disabilities. And the second is to develop strategies to plug disability issues, which are complex structures in and of themselves, into this big mother molecule in ways that achieve the most desired outcome. Unfortunately, this is going to be very difficult within the rather bleak macroeconomic context that you predict, and virtually everybody is predicting, one in which governments already vulnerable to insolvency due to a long history of profligate borrowing are pushed to the edge by the current economic crisis, forcing them to break their promises to pensioners, people with disabilities, and all recipients of government-funded health care. Very difficult. If this is really likely, the very first implication of your analysis for people with disabilities is that they must drastically lessen their dependence on government support. Unfortunately, again, in the absence of a complete rethinking of the relationship between society and its citizens with disabilities, such a process will have nothing but profound negative consequences for people with disabilities. Your model posits three obstacles to achieving the goals necessary for maximum social welfare and a sustainable future: values, institutions, and measurement. I believe that the most fundamental of these obstacles for people with disabilities are society's values. There's no getting around the fact that disability typically limits our functional capabilities and/or alters our appearance in ways that are understandably perceived as undesirable. Nobody really wants to be disabled. Most people resist thinking about people with disabilities beyond feeling sorry for them. Very few consider the fact that they or their loved ones can become disabled at any moment. Consequently, there has been a long-standing tradition of avoiding people with disabilities. Therefore, rather than being embraced by our able-bodied peers with empathy as fellow travelers, we are often looked at as an almost inferior species to be pitied, not embraced. This is changing for the better, but it still isn't great. People with disabilities that tend, therefore, to be the exception to your rule, Diane, the rule that I believe, that good policies are typically based on shared values and social norms. In our case, the shared values and social norms are often actually toxic to us. As you might imagine, this serious values problem has resulted in tremendous institutional problems. In your book, you mention the argument by Nobel laureates Ostrom and Williamson that different kinds of transactions require different kinds of institutions. Well, unfortunately, people with disabilities are harmed on a daily basis by important disability-related transactions that take place in inappropriate, inadequate, and sometimes counterproductive institutions. Consequently, people with disabilities tend to remain among the poorest, the least educated, the most underemployed, and most socially isolated segments of any population. Why is this so? For one, the physical aspects of society have tended to be constructed without taking people with disabilities into account. Again, this is getting better, but it's not great. The built environment is all wrong, and much of it intends to stay that way. For example, despite numerous laws, regulations, proclamations, and other institutionally sponsored hoo-ha, the New York subway system currently has an accessibility plan that will take at least 125 years to complete. And social norms are exclusionary at every juncture. A long history of isolating people with disabilities, first in brick and mortar institutions, and then in segregated institutional systems, has created a social stigma of incompetence and limited expectations that pervades all aspects of society. Wow, there's a number there, five. I'm on my way. Disability rules and institutions have traditionally been designed by people who know little about the actual needs and concerns of people with disabilities, and in many cases, who have obviously tended not to consider the possibility that they or their family members might someday be forced to enter the systems they create. As a result, disability interventions tend to range from merely inadequate to downright counterproductive. In this country, the merely inadequate systems include virtually all state rehabilitation agencies, and most, if not all, of the encouraging, very encouraging, but underfunded new Medicaid programs, many we've talked about here, the home and community-based services waiver, personal assistance services, targeted case management, et cetera. There are many actually counterproductive disability institutions, but I think the mother of them all in the United States is the Social Security Disability Insurance System, SSDI, which actually requires its disabled applicants to enter into poverty before applying and to stay there to remain eligible. Therefore, most people with severe disabilities find themselves trapped in poverty and forced to rely on dwindling government resources to supply their basic human needs. I mean, come on. To its credit, SSDI has developed a few add-ons over time to try to overcome this problem, but unfortunately, all of these have so far been inadequate, leaving the system as a whole as counterproductive as ever. What must be done to overcome these obstacles in the environment of scarcity that you envision, and most people envision, Diane? In terms of values, the general population must be brought to the understanding that disability is a club that they can join at any minute. They must be taught that accessible built environments and empowering disability systems serve as insurance for them against their having their lives unnecessarily ruined by disability. Society must come to understand and embrace the meaning of the world's shortest poem, written by, perhaps, one of the world's most famous disabled people, Muhammad Ali. Me, we. At the same time, people with disabilities must be supported to lessen their dependence on direct government support, which can only happen through a complete abandonment of the values that now support institutional systems like SSDI. Investments in such systems must be replaced by investments that make independent living a probability, not a remote possibility. New metrics, as has already been mentioned, are required, and current disability research must be very much reformed. Traditional research aimed at refining and improving existing outmoded and dysfunctional approaches to disability must be replaced by participatory and exploratory research aimed at determining what is really needed and how to best get it done. Thank you very much.